So welcome back to the channel with me, your host, Dr. Debra Durst, and my co-host.
Hey guys, Faraday Golembieski, family nurse practitioner here at RevitalyzeMD.
Have you guys ever actually tried to say her name? It took me forever to learn how to spell it. Wasn't that hard to say, but definitely was harder to spell. It still throws me off every once in a while.
It's got every letter in the alphabet just
every
about.
Letter, every single one. So, all right, so we're going to talk about hair growth. Like, hair thinning is a big issue. And so it is, again, a confidence issue for men and women. And it's very common as we get older. And 40% of women will start to thin as they get older. But it is a more severe issue for men because of androgenic hair loss. And so we're going to talk about just what the science is behind that. What happens with the hair follicle and what do we do to treat it? And what kind of physiologic effects are we going for with those treatments? So
exactly. So we'll just break down the stages of hair growth and then tune in because we'll have a couple other podcasts going into treatments, supplements, some great products that we offer. So check those out as well.
And the science behind all of those. So it's interesting because I think that hair growth is one of the hardest things to treat because it is so common. It has such an effect on what people are thinking when they walk out of the house every day. And it is on their minds all the time. So we realize the importance of it. And so I was kind of almost committed to finding some treatments for hair thinning as we get older. And so when we're talking about the hair follicle, the reason why some of our treatments are multifaceted is because we're basically trying to hit it from multiple different angles because it's a hard thing to treat. But the hair follicle will go through different phases. And so the first phase or the growth phase is the anagen phase. And most of the hair follicles are actually in that phase. And so most of our hair will live there. And 85 to 90% of our hair follicles are in that growth phase.
During this active growth phase, hair can grow up to a half an inch in length. So this is our, like Dr. Durst said, our active growth phase. This is where the most of our hair growth is occurring. This is where we want to live. This is the stage we want to prolong. More than any of the other stages.
Well, and most of the treatments are geared towards getting the hair follicle back into this active phase of growth and out of the telogen phase, which we'll get to. And so the hair follicle spends a lot of time in that, a 2 to 7 year period. And most of the effects, environmental, hormonal, age, different conditions, are going to affect the anagen phase or the growth phase. So that's the phase that we're trying to target when we're doing hair treatments. And so then the next phase is the transition phase. So if you just think of, I like to think of things in simple terms. You can get into deep science, but then it's hard to understand. And there's so much that goes on in our bodies and it's complex. It's a complex machine. But anagen's growth, the telogen is the resting, and in between is a transition phase or the catagen phase. And so you're basically kind of getting ready for the telogen phase, which is the shedding phase or resting phase. And so you'll transition and start to become, it's like a pre-shedding phase.
Yeah. As Dr. Durst said, this is a very short phase, just 2 to 3 weeks. It is old hair starting to get ready to start to shed.
Yes. And then it really doesn't last all that long, like 2 to 3 weeks, but it's only a short amount or a small percentage of your hair that's actually in this transition phase.
I think they said 1 to 2%.
1 to 2%. So, and then it's 10 to 15% in the next phase, which is the shedding or inactive phase of the hair follicle. And so that is, again, 10 to 15%. It lasts for months versus, you know, just weeks. And then again, the active phase is the one that lasts the longer, and that's the one we're targeting. So,
and during this shedding phase, you can lose 50 to 100 hairs a day. So, and lots of things affect that shedding. So as Dr. Durst kind of touched on, it can be androgens, it could be stress, it's environmental. So a lot of things can play a role into the shedding phase. So goal of treatment is to shorten the shedding phase and elongate the growth phase.
Yes, and transition it back over to that growth phase again. So One of our core treatments is PRF. And if you've heard of PRP, then PRF is just second generation PRP. And so what happens is with PRP, we are drawing blood, spinning it down, and getting the platelets, and platelets have growth factors in them. So we re-inject platelets into lots of places. The magic of the blood and healing.
Everywhere.
Yes, everywhere. And we mean everywhere. So basically, if you're thinking about it, platelets, like if you cut your arm and the platelets go to the cut, they stop the bleeding. And then there's growth factors that are released that communicate with the stem cells in an area. And then you regrow tissue in that area. So you would regrow skin in the arm instead of regrowing hair, like a scalp and or, you know, vaginal tissue or, you know, mucosa. You're going to actually, those growth factors will communicate with the stem cells in the area and then regrow that tissue. And so a lot of our, well, our core treatment, it's not a lot of, we're just taking PRF, which is a second generation PRP. So it extends the release of those growth factors over a longer period of time. And that's our core treatment.
Yep. And usually we're pairing that with laser treatments, supplements, some topical options, and those we'll get into in the next podcast.
Yes. Yeah. So we just wanted to talk about the hair follicle. Again, it's rotating through. So when we do in our core treatment is PRF, hair, and so that is injections that we do. And again, hair thinning is common. And even for women, and about 40% of women will get hair thinning as we get older. So when we see women in the office and we're evaluating them for hormones, a frequent complaint is hair thinning. And so it's something that happens a little bit later. The texture changes. There's lots of things. But if we're talking about a hair follicle that isn't as healthy, you're going to get a miniaturization of the hair follicle. So it gets smaller. There's not as many from each hair follicle bulb. So there's less hair follicles coming out and they're thinner as well. And so that's something that happens. And so texture changes. And so they notice all of that and it's bothersome. So we're doing injectable treatments as a core. What does PRP do to the hair follicle is the question. And that's why we wanted the phases of the hair growth cycle. So the one thing that it does is, again, I think if you just look at the overall goal, simply, we are trying to get it into the anagen phase and out of the telogen phase and a prolonged anagen. Thicker and
healthier follicles.
Yeah. And frequently when they grow it back, it does end up being thicker. So that miniaturization, which is not the easiest thing to say, is something that happens when you get hair thinning. And so the goal is to thicken that hair follicle back up. And so the other things that happen are the growth factors. So you have platelet-derived growth factors, vascular endothelial growth factors. So you're going to get an increased blood supply to the scalp, which is going to help the health of the hair follicle. Support of the tissue. So like you're going to have, you know, the scalp with better structural support for the hair follicle as well. Even immune, you know, effects. And so basically you will have immune modulation due to release of growth factors, and some hair loss is related to that, such as alopecia areata can be an immune issue. And so some people will come in thinking that PRP or PRF isn't going to be helpful for alopecia areata, but it actually is. And so, and it has all kinds of effects, blood flow, you know, just the growth factors overall that are going to affect the hair follicle, thickening, support, all of that. So
all of it.
I know.
And yeah. It's also important to know cause of hair loss. So very important to do a blood panel. Being with someone that's treating you comprehensively, a lot of our patients aren't just doing PRF. Mm-hmm. Like I mentioned earlier, we're doing some lasers. We are doing supplements. We are doing topical, but we're also looking at blood work, which is another component that's important, especially when we're trying to get down to the root cause of why we're losing hair. Typically, you know, it can be illness, it could be stress, but it can also be hormonal.
And so a lot of people will think that testosterone strictly is going to have an adverse effect on hair, and it potentially could if it is, you know, a higher conversion to DHT, which is a stronger metabolite, or again, if you have a level that's too high for you and the conversion is high, or you have fluctuations, because topicals tend to do a little bit more of that conversion to DHT than injections or pellets or something underneath the skin. So it really depends. So having somebody that is very well versed in hormone replacement therapy is important, because typically testosterone is an anabolic, and so it's typically going to grow and make hair healthier. But the conversion to the stronger metabolite can cause the opposite. So you want to make sure that you go to somebody that knows to prevent that if you're already a setup for thinning hair, but also that they look at your thyroid.
That's what I was going to say, is you can't forget the thyroid. The thyroid could be the cause of hair thinning or loss as well, or even brittle, weak hair, hair that breaks all the time, dry hair, all of that. Yeah. Contribute to thyroid.
And thyroid is not always looked at in the best way. And that's a traditional training, really. So we'll look at TSH in traditional medicine. And if we see a normal TSH, it's like you have a normal thyroid. But there's a lot of other factors there. And so the more data that you have, the better. And free T3 and free T4, you can even have antibodies if you really wanted to deep dive into a thyroid panel. But looking at free T3, free T4, and free T3 is the more active hormone. And that's important to look at those, because you might have a normal TSH but have a low free T3, and therefore even a subclinical where it doesn't even have to necessarily be low but not optimal. And so you can still treat it as somebody's having, they're cold all the time, they have hair thinning, you know, brittle hair, like you said, it's just unhealthy. And so that is something you can optimize.
And that can be medication or supplement. There's some great thyroid supplements out there now, so it doesn't all have to be prescription. But when we are talking about prescriptions, we're looking at more natural options and not synthetics. So again, it's really important to find someone that's looking at your health comprehensively and really deep diving into those specifics.
Yes. And so when we, just one last thing before we stop, because we hit it from many different angles. And so those injectables or PRF treatments are one, you know, as Faraday said, supplements are super important. Looking at the full hormone panels and picture is important, but topicals. So the more that we can hit it, the better. The laser treatments that go in between injectables. But we will just say PRF and PRP. I just wanted, and we do have another video way back that we did on the difference between the two. A lot of offices will do PRP injections for hair or for other treatments for regenerative, even aesthetics or sexual wellness. But when we look at PRP, there's lots of studies going way back to support regenerative and regrowth of and regeneration in different areas for PRP. Lots of studies and no adverse effects related to it because it's your own blood. But PRF is just a second generation. When we say that, what we mean is we're still drawing blood. We're just processing it in a way that is going to maximize the release of growth factors. So when we draw PRP, we're typically putting an anticoagulant in it, and that anticoagulant prevents the clotting so that we can inject that into, and sometimes we'll even activate it with calcium if the tissue wasn't very vascular, and that just helps release the growth factors. But with PRF, we don't put any anticoagulant in it. So we sometimes couldn't treat hair at first because we had to inject right away, because if not, it would clot before we got to inject it.
But we do want it to clot. That's the purpose. We just don't want it to clot so quickly we can't get it underneath the scalp where we need it.
Correct. And so what happens is now we have ways to prolong that PRF that we've drawn so that we have a little bit more time before we inject. But again, that's an office taking the time to really learn and deep dive into the latest of aesthetic and wellness treatments and how to process things and do it the best way possible. But now, as Faraday said, now we don't have an anticoagulant in it. We have prolonged it so we can inject it underneath the scalp and it still pushes. And so once we do that, then it interacts with the scalp tissue, and that fibrin clot that forms holds those platelets in place with release of growth factors over 2 to 3 weeks, so a longer period of time. So much more effective. And then if we are microneedling on the top of that and creating microchannels, putting topical on with stem cell and growth factors and, you know, and nutrients, then it seeps into the scalp more because you've created those microchannels. So that's all a good thing, and it increases inflammation and so therefore healing. So that's just PRP, PRF in a nutshell.
Just the iceberg, yeah. Just the tip of it.
Yeah, PRP, PRF in a nutshell, because frequently we get that
question. We do get asked.
You know, what is PRF? And so people don't know. So now we will end up, again, just kind of talking and doing other videos specifically that dive into supplements for hair growth and some products and ingredients that you might not have thought of. So you definitely want to stay tuned, like, and subscribe so you get notifications, because we are going to hit hair thinning and the science behind it in upcoming videos. So let us know if there's anything else you want to hear about, because we're willing to deep dive into anything. And thank you for listening.